you. Good afternoon. Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Robin Cotton, and I'm the historian of the Eastern Psychological Association. And as part of our this year's history program, I'm delighted to be speaking with Dr. Jerome Bruner. In many ways, Dr. Bruner requires no introduction. And at the same time, I think I would be remiss if I didn't begin today by reminding us of some of the highlights of Dr. Bruner's career, which has spanned nearly a century and continues today. Dr. Bruner was born in New York City on October 1st, 1915. He was graduated from Duke University in 1937 and immediately began his studies in psychology at Harvard, earning his master's in 1939 and his PhD 2 years later with a dissertation under the supervision of Gordon Allport. In 1945, after contributing to the war efforts, Dr. Bruner returned to teach at Harvard, reaching the rank of full professor by 1952. In 1960, with his colleague George A. Miller, he founded the Center for Cognitive Studies. It is his early cognitive perceptual work at Harvard that is often identified with the cognitive revolution in psychology. And many of the ideas and assumptions that Dr. Bruner maintained were quite unconventional at the time. He argued, for example, that people's minds are not blank slates, a dominant assumption of staunch behaviorists. Alternatively, Dr. Bruner conceived of the mind as active, constructive, and participatory. In other words, perception was not a passive process. Internal determinants, such as beliefs, emotions, expectations, intentions, shape our perceptions. One famous experiment had poor and rich children estimate the size of coins, and the poor children exaggerated the size while the rich children did not. This study and others like it led to what was then called the new look in perception, because it focused on how individuals' intentions and emotions affect their perception. As Watt's professor of psychology at Oxford University, he broadened his cognitive work, focusing on children's cognitive and linguistic development and the role of education in this process. Based on his empirical studies at the time, he argued that babies have a guiding sense of intention that regulates their cognitive development. Babies were not passive learners, as was often assumed. And it was this very idea that was the genesis of what would become the Head Start program for preschoolers. In the early 80s, Dr. Bruner joined the New School for Social Research in New York City, where he became an evangelist for the importance of a cultural psychology, criticizing the cognitive revolution for its overemphasis on computer models of mind. Dr. Bruner emphasized the centrality of meaning and how human beings construct their understanding of their world and of themselves. He is currently a professor at New York University Law School, where he applies the use of narrative to the law. He is the author of over 20 books, and his 1960 book, The Process of Education, has been translated into over 17 languages. He has been the recipient of numerous honorary degrees and awards, and we would literally need at least a month of these sorts of conversations to cover the breadth and depth of Dr. Bruner's illustrious career. Today, I hope to highlight some of the interesting things that have come up in our conversations over the past few months. So, thank you for being here. So, yeah, here you are. So thanks again for being with us today.
Great pleasure.
Yes. And I guess the first place we'll start is, what got you into psychology?
I've been asking myself that, Robin. It's not an easy one. I think it had to do first with the relationship between me and my sister Alice, who was slightly brighter than I. And at least I came rapidly to that particular conclusion. And I kept saying, why does she do some of the things that she did? It was then that I started making up some psychology. And I remember that one of the things that I thought you had to have in psychology is how people make up possible ways of doing things, that possibility was very important. I didn't call it that. God only knows what I called it at the age of 10. But And I even remember one funny episode. Right next to my house, there was on Seneca Street, there was a little post box where we drop your mail like that. And on it was the usual U.S. mail, U.S.M.A.I.L. like that. And I remember walking by it one day and saying, U.S.M.A.I.L. But that could mean lots of other things, like, for example, Uncle Sam married an Irish lady. And for the life of me, I have no idea why that crazy notion stuck with me. But there it was, that if you use your bean, you have possible worlds. I had it, but I had a favorite collie dog, Dunk, in those days. He didn't have it, but he could respond to my possible world. So it's that interesting kind of, well, I could go on and on. You carry on.
Okay. All right. Well, so possible worlds it started when you were around 10, thinking in terms of possibilities,
except
even though you didn't use those.
I can't believe that I used that kind of expression when I was that age, but anyway.
But you were thinking about it.
Something like that, yeah.
So from our conversations, I understand that there was a lot going on during your teenage years. Although I understand your family was all right financially, you grew up during the Depression and during the buildup to World War II, and moreover, your father passed away when you were 12. How do you think these things influenced you personally and in terms of your psychological thinking?
Well, I know, it's hard to know with respect to psychological thinking, but the personal things that were related to it had to do principally with the business of what it means, quote, to be on your own. And that led me to think about mind as not only being aware of what exists, but mind in terms of possibility, of generating, that is, mind as a hypothesis generator. And at that particular time, the world was divided. I have to say a little word about my psychological background as an undergraduate, as a kid. The world was divided between the kind of idealists who thought about man and his powers and as being godlike and so on like that, as compared to thinking of man as some kind of a reflector of the contingencies and the environment and just that, like that. And my feeling at that stage was that there was something you could do that would move man toward thinking about possibilities in a creative world. And I guess it was right around then, for the first time, maybe I was 12 and I certainly didn't use this word, that I thought about hypotheses, I guess. Like my sister Alice used to say about me, "Why are you always guessing, Sonny?" The answer was I wasn't guessing, I was trying out. And I had never heard of psychology. It never occurred to me, nobody in my family. The venturesomeness, I think, in a funny kind of way, my father was a watch manufacturer and made Bruner watches that later sold to Artie Bulova and became part of the Bulova Empire. And he would go off to Europe once a year to visit the factory that manufactured the movements of the thing, the cases being made here in New York. And I would go down to see him off here in New York Harbor. And goodness, I was swept off my feet thinking about it. And I would go on. I remember one particular trip he took on a ship called the Leviathan. How many people have ever heard of the Leviathan? Yeah, it was the biggest ship in the world, but it's now been forgotten. We take United Airlines 473 instead. But in any case, I mean, I kept thinking about my father going off to Switzerland to have a look at the factory there and going all the way across the ocean. And at the same time, I was becoming an ocean kid. That is, there was a boatyard in our, right next to our village that was run by a guy named Frank Henning. It's funny how vividly I remember him. He was kind of my nautical father. And he let us take out rowboats and then little sailboats afterward. And so very early I became a water rat. And I think partly the water rat was following my old man across the sea. I didn't get to Switzerland, which is not on the sea. but anyway, there was that interesting kind of connection of possibility, water, greatness, and unknowability. And that's enough of that. Your questions about thinking about the possible.
Thinking about the possible, not what is, but what could be or what might be.
Yeah. And I should say one other thing about that was school was very boring to me. I went to public schools. And I had one teacher who I think recognized that this was kind of a crazy little kid, that she should sort of stimulate this kind of thing. Her name was Miss McNamara. I think she was fourth, fifth, sixth grade, something like that. She's the greatest teacher I ever had, something like that. The world was an open question, and that was terrific. We were learning geography in those days, and I swear, Robin, I still have in my head the maps, those formulated maps from around the time of Columbus or whatever it is. Like that. Go on with your questions.
Okay. So you told me that you were very anti-Hitler during that time and that you wanted to fight the Nazis. Could you talk about how you ultimately joined the war effort?
Well, I hated Hitler. I'm Jewish, or at least mostly Jewish, but never mind the exception. And I wanted, as I had learning the phrase in those days, to kill the bastard. And I was going to get over there and do it somehow. So I applied to get into the army and went to the draft board. They did the test and they told me I had insufficient vision. Insufficient vision. I should tell you, I was born blind and had my the great Algernon Rees removed my lenses, and I was able to see, and with good vision, by the technique called the camera obscura rather than the camera lucida, which means that as I focused by changing the size of my pupil rather than changing the shape of my lens. And I have never been to an optician or an eye doctor who doesn't look at me with glasses like that and say, "You see too well." Whatever that means, which means that some of the technology of eye surgery is not caught up with the opticians yet. So I couldn't join, and I joined an organization that was monitoring German broadcasts called the Foreign Broadcast Intelligence Service in Washington, which was supposed to be secret. I'm not sure why it was secret. Anybody could listen to them, thing like that. And it's a funny kind of a thing. I don't know that I know all the details myself, but anyway, through one kind of thing and another, various cousins and friends and so on like that, I got myself shipped to Europe. I got myself shipped to England, and the last phases of the Blitzkrieg was going on, a lot of bombing and so on like that. And as I would say to myself in those days, I'll get that bastard yet, meaning Hitler. So I couldn't get it. So at that time, there was a general assigned to a new task in Washington. His name was Dwight Eisenhower. And he set up something which was called Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Force, SHAEF. And he interesting. They wanted to set up something called a psychological warfare division, PWD, and staff it with people who could do something about checking to see whether our advance, once we invaded, because the plan was an invasion, would get ahead. So I, slightly illegally in England, I was not illegally, but illegitimately, let me put it that way, I got into them and landed on Normandy Beach on D plus two, insufficient vision and all. It was not altogether a privilege. I can tell you, being strafed by a Luftwaffe plane is no fun. I did nothing to be heroized either, because from being strafed by a plane going 400 miles an hour or something like that turns you into an absolute coward. There on the thing like that. Anyway, that made me want to get them all the more. So off we went, and we went advancing on with our PWD thing like that, and we were beating the daylights out of the Germans, because the fact of the matter is that we had more troops and we had better strategies, and being on the defense ain't the world's best position to be in militarily, personally, or in a love affair, or anything. So we got to Paris, and in Paris, they wanted to demilitarize as fast as possible, and they were going to set up a cultural attaché, and they chose the poet Archibald MacLeish, who was quite a guy, to be the guy, but he was still in America, and he couldn't come, and then he fell ill, and the then acting ambassador there, a man by the name of Cass Canfield, said, in effect, Jerry, could you sort of pro tem serve in the role of the kind of the cultural attaché here in Paris? I wasn't yet turned 30, until we get the real person to do it, so I was kind of the fake cultural attaché for like that, and. But along the way, I kept meeting these other people who also thought that they were fakes like me, like Jean-Paul Sartre, Simone de Beauvoir, and people of that kind, who would have, it's just by chance that I happen to speak French, because I had a cousin in Paris, but that's not important. So for the first time, I think explicitly, I became aware of the fact that there are philosophical formulations that follow upon your taking action of one kind as compared to another. That is, the action takes place on a philosophical basis, but you don't know the basis until you reflect upon it later. And that became very much part of my cultural psychology later. But never mind. So, and the one thing I found out from Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir was that thinking not only was an artistic activity, a literary activity, but also a very penetrating activity. And so, as the very same Sister Alice said to me when I got back to America, you've become a goddamn Frenchman. And so I did for a little while. But anyway, so I was there working on the question of the formulation of one nation by another, and the extent to which politics had a deep social, psychological, cultural root, and that part of the exchange process consisted of doing it in some appropriate way by exchange and so on like that. So we started an exchange process and brought a lot of people over from America. And I remember one of them particularly, who was later got to be a very good friend, I'd known him before, who was professor of English at Harvard, a guy by the name of Perry Miller. Some of you may know who he is. He's written some very interesting books. And Perry Miller said, you know, It's interesting. There are various times in American history when people asking about the psychological human roots of national policy, and what you're doing is repeating that, the way in which lots of other people who are much more eminent and clever than you did, including one Thomas Jefferson, for example, raising the question about what do you have in mind about this thing you call the Constitution, and that it's a good thing to do. So anyway, yeah. So, yeah, next question.
Well, you had mentioned a while back that you had a 2.5-year psychoanalysis with Edward Bibring. And one of my clinical supervisors once told me that psychotherapy is never a neutral experience. It's either positive or negative, or I guess both. How would you characterize your experience with psychoanalysis?
Positive and negative.
Could you say more? Could you say more about it?
I had a wonderful analyst, Edward Bibring, who had been analyzed by Freud himself. He was rather an older man and a very wise one. And this was, my fellowship wasn't because I was particularly sicker then than I am ordinarily, but had to do instead with the fact that the Commonwealth Fund thought it would be good for people in the human sciences to get acquainted with this Freudian technique. So it handed out, or made us compete, for free analyses, and I got a free analysis. And maybe that was not a good thing. Maybe you should have to pay while you're going on. But anyway, I didn't have to pay, thank the Lord. Because anyway. So my analysis was interesting because I was interested in the more intellectual side. I mean, where the hell did I get these ideas, you know? And Bibring was much more interested in how I fit the classical psychoanalytic pattern of a gentleman named Sigmund Freud. And I read a lot of Freud, liked him very much, enjoyed him, and had the feeling, I guess I strongly developed the feeling then, that a field like psychology, because of the fact that there are so many cultural roots by which one grows up, needs different spokesmen, needs different ways of formulating itself. So it was a really good experience, but Bibring was convinced that all the while that I had a tendency to intellectualize too much. He was probably right, but I keep saying even now, what's wrong with intellectualizing? But intellectualization is a bad thing in psychoanalytic theory, do you hear? So it went on for about 2 years. And it was a period of, interesting consciousness raising. I don't like that word, raising. Consciousness rippling all the time. I had new thoughts, and it was during that time too that my research at this point was starting off with things like the new look and perception, or how do people organize the world, and so that my intellectual life and my quote clinical life and my personal clinical life fitted together in an interesting kind of way, and I still have the feeling that it drove Dr. Bibring up the wall a little bit. You're supposed to be thinking along classical lines. But my classical lines somehow were related to the novelists I was reading. I mean, it was during that same period that a then fairly new novelist, John Dos Passos, came on the scene. And I loved those John Dos Passos novels. And I would even read them twice. And I remember my dear sister Alice saying, "You read a novel twice? What's the matter with you anyway?" And I said, "You get something more the second reading." And she said, "You do, you nut." But I did. So what do I get? I get a chance to go meta, which made me think about another form of thinking. That is, you can think about objects, you can think about your thinking, or you can think about your thinking about your thinking about your thinking. And all of those are important, and all of them are part of the human condition. And that was part of the, I mean, even in perception, that was part of the cognitive revolution. But yeah,
that was a great segue, Dr. Bruner, because that's where we were headed. I was going to ask you about that. Your early work at Harvard is identified with the cognitive revolution, or the start of the cognitive revolution in psychology. In one of your remembrances of George Miller, you had described psychology at Harvard when you were there as split. You had described that, you know, you had explained how the experimental psychologists formed or belonged to the Department of Psychology, while social, developmental, and clinical combined with sociology and social anthropology to form the Department of Social Relations, of which you were a part. Yeah. Could you say a bit about how you worked outside that split?
Well, first of all, that's not easy to say. I had the feeling that the split was to spare people from thinking about the complexities of human nature, and that unless you took into account the social, cultural, as well as the biological, you didn't have an account of the human condition. And we used to talk about this, and I was in social relations, and they were perfectly nice and honest gang of people like Dwalkett Parsons and Sam Stauffer and others like that. And in psychology, George Miller and Fred Skinner. Fred Skinner was one of those wonderful, how to work out psychopathology in a profession. But I'll come to that.
Can you say more about that? Could you say more about that?
Yeah, I will in a second, but let me just... Yeah, I didn't mean to say that, but now that I have, I'm committed. that somehow, how to put it, to understand the human condition, you could not say, don't tell me anything about anthropology, for example, because if you don't understand the environment, how in the hell do you understand how it is to live in that environment? So we had a bunch of people in the Socrel department, people like Clyde Cluckhone and his wife Florence, and so on like that, who were wonderful, who gave me a new sense of, plus the fact that I spent the summer with the Cherokee and felt what it's like to get outside your own skin, and you all know what it's like. And also reading like, and then there were those who say, don't divert me from the true story, which is the real nature of man, which is his body. Do you understand? Yeah, sure. This was Fred Skinner. And Fred, he was a very nice guy and a very learned guy. And we could talk perfectly well about novels. He also liked John Dos Passos' novel. Talking about novels, but the moment we got into psychology, fermez la bouche. we would. Okay, he had a swim. He lived down the block from me on Twin Drive, so we would have an occasional swim, and he had a little backyard pool, and a drink afterward, and never, ever say a word about psychology. We would talk about novelists and even political philosophers and about those characters in Washington and so on like that. But I'm very proud of this. I think we both knew that we were totally incompatible. And yet we had to live together. And he was in the psychology part and what we call the biotropes, and I was in the sociotrope, at which particular point two of my friends, George Miller and Noam Chomsky, the linguist, said, why are you trying to hang around with those characters? Let's set up something of our own. And so we went to John Gardner at the Carnegie Corporation and said, we're fed up with this split at Harvard. We want to set up something that would include both, called the Center for Cognitive. Could you give us any money? So John's response was very interesting. Boy, have I been awaiting this. So we got money and set up the Center for Cognitive Studies and had the damnedest collection of bright students and interesting research. And I wrote a book called A Study of Thinking, which I think reflected something of that same sense. It came out, I think, in 1956 or something like that. And we set up a couple of years later. But the idea of making psychology something that had to do with the human condition, and that the human condition is studied in different ways. There's no way of putting it all together yet. Hopefully there may be someday. Kept us moving. Then it was a funny kind of a thing. I mean, well, one of the things I noticed at that particular point, which is very funny, which continues to this day, in a field of this sort, you get attacked like mad. The more you're attacked, like, for example, the business of taking into account the requirement for economy, the fact that we have a limited 7 plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2 capacity, that limits the world that we construct. The more you do radical things of that sort, and the more you get attacked, the more likely later that they'll end up sticking a throne on your head and giving you an honorary degree. So psychology, therefore, strikes me as a field which has always been torn in conflict between positive points of view, one of them with the aim of economy, and let's make this as much like physics as possible, the other with the point of view of let's at least try to understand, even if we don't look good at department meetings, you know. So that's how it is. And so it is today. And, you know, but you,
to what extent did you conceive of what you were doing as revolutionary?
The word that never crossed my mind. Revolutionary? It's sensible. That's not. who needs revolutionary, for God's sake? Yeah.
Was it revolutionary? To what extent was it?
Why don't you ask an historian that? I don't know. I don't know. The only thing I can say, colleagues saying to you, boy, you sure changed my way, you guys changed my way of thinking. And the idea that, for example, there was a formal code that had to do with how you put a sense together, going to some of Noam Chomsky's work like that, govern the structure of language and so on like that. That was revolutionary, but it's been a revolution that's been going on. I mean, I say going on for a long time because you go back, I mean, funny thing to say, it occurred to me before. You go back and you read one of your favorites from your late teen, early 20s, like Aristotle's De Anima, a book, by the way, I recommend. It is fantastic. How smart that guy was and ahead of his time is unbelievable. But you read the De Anima, and you think maybe there are perpetual questions that have tortured the mind of man forever, and that maybe this is part of what it is being human, that we are a species that are intellectually troubled. That is, it's great to be smart, but it's awful to be smart. Both.
Double-edged sword.
What's a
double-edged sword?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a double-edged sword, and you're always cutting your finger on one edge or the other. Then it continues, and it finds later editions. I mean, when you read somebody like Plotinus, only a couple of centuries after Aristotle, and so on, you say, "Why in the hell didn't he read Aristotle too? Was it a villain?" You know.
Okay. Would you speak about your transition from Harvard to Oxford?
We had a visiting professor, who was a friend of mine, from Oxford at Harvard, by the name of Isaiah Berlin. Surely some of you have heard of him. And Isaiah loved exploring the unknown, and we used to have a wonderful time. The only requirement was that there be a good meal, that a decent wine with the meal, and some place to sit down comfortably with a glass of cognac afterward. And we'd have the conversations going on. And I said, I love you because you're a goddamned Englishman and you don't know any constraints on what you can talk about intellectually, and that really works well. So then that was also the time when Harvard was going through terribly rough times with a president whose name I'll bet most of you have forgotten, Nathan Pusey. Oh, I hope you've forgotten it. who wanted to keep the university apart from great political issues. We're not a political institution. We're an intellectual institution. Did you hear? So in any case, I was getting into real troubles about the role of the university in student activity and faculty activity and so on like that. And just around that time, there opened at Oxford a new professorship of psychology. And the committee was set up to select candidates. And Isaiah was on the committee. And Isaiah said to me, "You got any suggestions, Jerry?" And I thought for a moment, and much to my surprise, I said, "Oh, yeah, me." He said, "You? You got a job already." So I said, "Anything to get away." anything to get away from that Nate Pusey. I can't stand him. So
so how did you physically get there?
To Oxford?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was a great question. So I decided to go to Oxford. And then I thought to myself, I have my beloved boat, Wester Till, which I sail down to Bermuda every year for the Bermuda race and so on like that. Am I going to leave that beloved boat behind? So I raised the question with various of my friends, particularly people who crewed with me. Now, we had the highest average IQQ in the Bermuda races every year. and that didn't cause us to win, however. But it made some good conversation on board. And as somebody said, the trouble with you guys, you get so involved in philosophy that somebody has to slap the other guy on the shoulder and say, "Hey, the direction of the wind has changed." So anyway, yeah. So then, I got a terrific amount of correspondence from my colleagues, all of which contained something of the order of, I can understand why, but I'm very sorry you decided to. I wish you were here to continue the fight and so on. Those were very rough times academically. No, you're too young to remember that, I think. When did you enter the academic world?
99.
What's that?
99.
Oh, no. It was way, way before your time. Way before your time. Anyway, so off I went. And so the great, there was no problem about finding a place to live in Oxford and so on like that. The real question was, how in the hell was I going to get my beloved boat, Wester Till, across the ocean? So we decided the only thing you could do with, I looked into the question of how much it would cost to ship as deck cargo, which was about twice as much as it had cost me to buy in the first place. So I decided that wouldn't, anyway. So I got my little Bermuda race gang together. And we decided to do it. And I believe that I may at least have one historical distinction. I am the only Oxford professor in the history of that ancient university who ever sailed his own boat across the Atlantic Ocean to come occupy his chair. Now, and thank you.
Well, it seems like sailing has always been a very important part of your life, starting from when you were really young. Could you say a little bit about what sailing means to you?
Yeah, I think I can say it very, I've thought about this a fair amount. It means bringing man-made intelligence, even a certain amount of geometry, to bear on an absolutely unpredictable and beastly medium, and succeeding at it. And let me tell you, it isn't that it makes you feel vain, but it certainly makes you feel secure. And being, and not just being a good sea captain, but I'm one hell of a good navigator too, I want you to know. I mean, not just sun navigation, but using the tables. And I haven't used all the most recent machinery because I've given up sailing in the last 5-6 years. I mean, there's new machinery coming all the time.
Mm-hmm. So, but I mean, you were describing the paradox of how it can make you feel secure and strong and at the same time very small because it's you and the broad ocean.
Yeah, the ocean's a big place.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a big place and it's a very curious kind of thing. It is, on one occasion, it is brutally unforgiving and what the hell are you doing on trying to sail on my back? And on the others, it's an absolute delight. On a beautiful day and right into the night, when the stars come out where they're supposed to be and you take your sextant to them or something like that.
But it's just those conflicts, I mean, just that paradox is kind of a microcosm for your other thinking as well, that you kind of embrace the conflicts.
Yeah, well, that's the fun human conflict, torn between the possible and the necessary, the impossible and the necessary. This is impossible but necessary, and we do it. Like form societies or hold meetings like the Eastern Psychological Association, what? In New York, I mean, how do you do that? I mean, yeah. So it goes when you begin to understand something about human evolution and the way in which primate society develops and baboons and the rest of it. There is that somehow the juxtaposition of order and fatal chaos and finding a thing between it. And I think, by the way, it's the fact that we live constantly torn in that conflict that leads us to such great inventions as drama. I think drama is such an instance of taking these impossible situations and finding segmental solutions to them that turns the victims into heroes or turns the heroes into victims. Either way, yeah. The great impossible, yeah. 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 I made a little list here of things I want to say. Yeah. Yeah, there was one thing. The one thing I wanted to say was the emphasis, the emphasis that the kind of the new look and the cognitive revolution started on constructivism. The fact that the world as in its finished state does not come in upon you, but comes in upon you as a challenge. And that your task is to take this challenge and construct something of it that has some meaning, turning things into meaning. And I mean, this is relevant to the way in which kids in their first, well, starting particularly at toward the end of their second year when I started doing my study. I've spent a decade or so working with little kids and being amazed at the way in which they move into linguistic patterns, and with it comes a way of understanding the world and reaching for things. But that's part. To understand that means going beyond psychology, because the fact of the matter is that if I take my own life, for example, I was mentioning the novelist John Bud Dos Passos. And one of the things about John Dos Passos in the novel called, what is it called, USA, the USA trilogy or whatever it was, like that, is that there's stories of events going on and so on like that. And then in between, there are little sections about the possible worlds that might be at that time like that. And I was fascinated. And I thought, how the hell, which is more important to write about? What happened or what might have been? And what might be in some future kinds of things like that. And so it is. And that's why I want to see psychology not try always to imitate sort of reflexological biology, which is even out of fashion in biology, but to take a look at how we create, how we make the possible fit what we're going to encounter and to change it like that. And it characterizes everything from the most intimate relationship, the and this is where it's so striking that is in a good relationship between a man and a woman, for example. The thing that's still characteristic, I mean, when you think over your friends, couples, so on like that, the ones that are really happy in their lives are the ones who manage somehow to both challenge each other and reinforce the other. And so it is in Washington, D.C., or in Geneva, Switzerland, with governments and government policy. I mean, so I want to say a psychology that doesn't deal with the generation of possibility is a psychology that has nothing to do with life.
Sterile. So what would it take for that to become not just a possibility but a reality?
Well, I think it's moving that way. But I think it needs at least three additional things from what it's got now. It's got to get out of the habit of just dealing with one homogeneous kind of subject. This business of sticking with undergraduates or kids from one social class. The thing that's so interesting is to get a sense of the variability in human behavior and its capacity to deal with the different kinds of challenges. You go ahead, try to characterize the human habitat. I mean, it's so varied. On the other hand, I can do a fairly good job of characterizing the elephant's habitat. I say that because I've just... I just read a poem of T.S. Eliot's that was in my... on the elephant's world, but yeah, you know the one. Yes. The generative capacity of the human mind is fantastic. And in so many domains, I mean, and for it we pay very dearly too. I mean, we get a great profit, but like most interesting gambles, human life is the gamble of whether you hit it strong or whether it hits you between the eyes. And I still don't know for sure how you guarantee one or the other. So you get people who are pessimists, and people who are pessimists think that it's always going to get you between the eyes, and people who are optimists think you're always going to really hit it strong. And what sets off those two things, how you put them together, how you put the comparison of the optimistic and the pessimistic point of view in opposition to each other when kids are young and capable of doing that, the way my dearly beloved Mr. McNamara did in our fifth grade class. There are two ways of looking at it, you know, kind of thing like that. And it was interesting. Maybe I needed somebody too. I had a neighbor girl on Seneca Street was in my class, Gracie Hecker, who later worked on the editorial page of the New York Times. We used to come away from Miss McNamara's class and, you know, jaws slightly dropped and say, "You mean that maybe Columbus might not have found America and that there would be none now?" So as Gracie would say, "So where would we be?" You which got me thinking. And I still haven't stopped thinking about that one. But
well, I know we're almost out of time, but just as a final question, what advice would you give to psychologists today?
What a challenging question. Well, the one advice I would give psychology is, for God's sakes, get the hell out into the world. Don't just stick in the laboratory. It's useful sticking in the laboratory too. Get out into the world. Study man's situation. Because, as my dear teacher, Kurt Levine, used to say, man is a response to his situation. And at the same time, man also creates the next situation, someone like that. So I wonder whether psychology should just live with itself, whether we shouldn't be part of anthropology, part of history. I can offer you as an example of this. I mean, I mentioned Aristotle's De Anima before because it happens to be a book I love dearly. And it's only about 40 pages long or something like that. But something that psychology needs something to shake it up a little bit. It's too, we know the answer, that is to say, it's either associationist or behaviorist or Gestalt or Rogerian. Come on, these are all possible ways, and I want a more comparative anthropological approach, and I think that there was something wonderful about the idea that we had at Harvard of setting up that Department of Social Relations that combined all of those fields, except for the fact that once we got together, each of those fields started being even more imperialistic than it might have been on its own, so they were constantly fighting each other. So George Miller and I, with some goading also from our pal Noam Chomsky, said in effect, je m'en fous, we've had enough of that, we'll set up our own thing. And it worked well.
I'd say so.
Yeah, I think it did anyway.
I think so. Thank you so much, Dr. Bruner.
And thank you very much for all of your interested and intense faces. Perfect.